the market's got to have to grapple with a number of outcomes. Yeah. One is the liquidation event finished? And none of us really know yet, but it's, you know, then there's probably, I think we both think there's probably a respite phase, whatever that is, whether that's a real recovery, which is what you said. Then we get inflation issues. Maybe things change. We've got an enormous amount of stimulus coming through eventually, et cetera, particularly after the election in the US as well. What happens if growth remains negative year on year and ongoing for a while? Because if I look at the psychological impact of what's happening, if I look what's happening in Hong Kong, which is now seeing a rise in cases again, if I see what Singapore's just done, the Singapore Prime Minister had a fabulous speech where he just said, listen, it's basically broken for a year or two, whether you like it or not. We're never going to open our borders, and we're going to be closing down the population from time to time. So all that says to me, all of this stuff and the scarring of people's behaviours means that the trend rate of growth goes down significantly for a period of time, right? So the question is how long that period of time is. I am focused on, I think if we go to three quarters of negative year-on-year growth, because the QQ growth is going to be impossible now because of this last quarter. So let's say, we go from depression quarter to bad recession few quarters, okay? Which would be normal, right? Normally in a recession, you kind of got 18 months of this stuff.
Right.
I fear an insolvency event.
Ah.
That's my biggest fear, and it's my highest probability that we have the largest insolvency event in history. That's what I'm looking at. And I know, again, neither of us know. We don't have a clue. We're just trying to look at what the probabilities are out there. Talk to me about that.
Well, thanks for such an easy question. Let's try and nut that out a bit in an effort to be less wrong. I mean, let's face it. If we get any of this half right, we're doing very well. So let's try and think about less wrong.
Yeah.
And what we know.
Okay. Yeah.
We know that we have a very tightly bound, complex system called the global economy that for decades has been optimized to a fault. Just-in-time inventory, just-in-time liquidity, just-in-time borrowings, just-in-time leverage, supply chains going every which way. It's a very complex system. And therefore, the notion, not held by you, of course, but the notion that we can flick a switch and turn this complex system off and then reflate it in a quarter or two, I think is wishful thinking.
Yeah.
Because think about incentives. Pending the arrival of the small business loan or the PPP loan or the unemployment check in my account, which in the United States might in some unfortunate circumstances still take another month, what am I doing? I'm knuckling down. I'm hunkering down every which way. My consumption, other than of Netflix, is going to zero. I'm not buying anything. I'm not spending. And economy-wide and globally, that is a very bad outlook. And businesses everywhere are incentivized to fire employees first, ask questions, apply for loans later. And then imagine, to extrapolate this example, the dilemma for small business owners around the world. And we were talking about it a bit earlier. It's not terribly social for you and I to agree to go to a bar in which we have to stand 20 feet apart. I mean, no bar owner is going to open that one up, and we're not going to turn up for a drink. And then the restaurant. Do we all have to have, you know, sit three tables apart? Why would any small businessman reopen if their revenues are going to be at best 50% of peak revenue?
That's exactly my point.
Which is your point. And the answer is they may not do that. No matter how grand the government largesse, no matter how long the PPP loans go for and everything else, look, in the United States right now, I'm not sure about other jurisdictions, but in the United States in particular, we are not yet arresting the rise in jobless claims. We are not yet arresting the rise in unemployment. We are chasing it.
Yes.
And that's most unfortunate. But knowing that and observing that, if we're daring to sketch any kind of economic recovery in the world's most important economy, bearing in mind that the US consumer has been the world's consumer of first resort for decades, then we are penciling in not only a very patchy recovery for the United States, but a very patchy recovery for the global economy, because as we seek to move through this, the global economy will only be as strong as its weakest link, right? So where I come out, and we could go into more details, but for the sake of time, if we can muddle through this with some kind of L-shaped recovery for two or three quarters, I would take that, because I think that would be a phenomenal outcome.
Correct.
Phenomenal outcome. I actually hope it's an L-shaped recovery. It's certainly the intent of fiscal authorities and monetary authorities around the world that we don't have an exact rerun of the Great Depression. I mean, it's remarkable. It's breathtaking, Raoul, that we have turned off the global economy. We've turned it off. Some estimates I've read have said there's a billion people at home right now just waiting for an employment check or waiting for the bailout. And the idea that you flick a switch and we all go back to work, or we all take the Lexington Avenue Express, the 4 or 5 train, or we all rushed back to get on the tube.
So here's something interesting. So a couple of things. Obviously, China kind of asked people to go back to work, to go to factories.
Well, because they can. That's another important point. We have command and control in China.
So what happens is, if you look at the TomTom data for Shanghai, weekend traffic is still down 80%. So people go to work, but on the weekend, they don't go out because they don't want to. Also, they've now got factories building stuff to sell to who exactly?
Well, that's it.
This is why I worry about solvency, because you've got this rolling issue of subdued demand. It's either catastrophic demand, as it is right now, but on and off, if you knock Brazil out of the global economy for a few months, you knock India out for a few. I mean, you've got this rolling destruction of demand. That whole situation just really concerns me, just to see that people, there is no normality. People don't go back to normal. It doesn't happen quickly. I mean, obviously in due course, but supply chains, everybody's going to have to change. I mean, the trade tariffs already started it.
Yeah.
And now every boardroom is going to have to say, can we allow for this weakness?
That's it. And at a minimum, there will be a much increased preference for cash as opposed to just-in-time leverage, refinancing and everything else. There will be much increased preference for cash, as I think a lot of corporations are finding out, even in a low-yield world. And we need to be very mindful, Raoul, that that does not become self-fulfilling, because then if every corporation around the world and every household around the world says, I prefer cash over every other asset, and to be clear, we are not there. We're not there yet. We may never get there. But that is your classic liquidity trap, which the authorities are doing their best to avoid. And in a liquidity trap, by definition, you have some very serious solvency problems, because not many people can refinance at any price. And that's not good. But to be clear, look, we can guess various letters for an economic recovery, and we can speculate endlessly on how difficult it is to restart this complex financial system, complex system called the global economy. But that doesn't mean we should not be looking to invest. Mm-hmm. We have to keep an eye on some of the extraordinarily attractive assets that have been coughed up over the past month and may yet be copped up. To talk specifically about insolvencies, and you mentioned it earlier about high yield, and I think it's very interesting and important that the Fed has made no effort to backstop the riskier parts of the US credit markets, and it's not an accident. And if we think about the politics of what we're sketching out here, which is, I hate to say it, human misery and human tragedy, which hopefully we can work our way through. But the optics, the political optics of the Fed, or frankly any other central bank, bailing out the financial system yet again before money has arrived in the bank accounts of consumers and households and small businesses around the world, it's not a good look. And Yet everyone tells me, oh, don't worry. The Fed's going to be on the hook for all the credit. They're going to buy high yield. They're going to do this. They're going to buy CLOs. You know, you go down the credit food chain, they're going to be the buyer. I'm not holding my breath. And they have been consistent. I know it's hard to divulge from what the Fed's been saying for several years, but if you read between the lines, they have been laying down a marker on commercial real estate, CMBS, leveraged loans. They have, in conjunction with their peers around the world, been warning for 5 or 6 years about something you and I've chatted about, which is secondary market illiquidity in corporate bond markets. And to then do a handbrake turn and support every part of the credit market sub-investment grade would be setting them up as a political punching bag, especially if this unfortunate crisis drags out for more than 1 or 2 quarters.
So why do they not do it via the municipal pension system? So why don't they just inject money into the pension? That's my theory, because like you, I think it's impossible politically to go and buy the high yield market. But to say, well, the pension system, we need to make sure that they're solvent and you inject money into them, because they're basically funded by tax receipts at the moment. So there's no tax receipts. So the Fed can essentially, or the Treasury, I mean, the Treasury or the Fed can, or government, whichever mechanism, inject money into those with the, you can support the credit markets for us.
I think you're asking me what's the probability of a state bailout and then what's the probability of a local bailout across the United States.
Yeah.
You are seeing some minor improvement in the municipal bond market, which is no surprise because, like so many risk assets over the past month, the enormity of the Fed and other central bank responses has injected this enormous amount of liquidity, which has reflated pretty much everything, right? Just to give people time to regroup and think about what they own. And the municipal market has benefited to some extent. Rather than getting too involved in a direct bailout of state and local pension authorities, perhaps part of the idea of the CARES Act potentially is to create some kind of special purpose vehicle for state borrowers. I don't know yet. But again, I come back to the point, I'm sure they've thought about it, and yet isn't it interesting that they haven't done it? So I don't have a great answer for you other than pointing out they haven't done it, and there must be a reason for that. Maybe they're hoping that the liquidity eventually trickles down from some of their other programs and that there's an element of balance sheet capacity and arbitrage which brings parts of the muni market back into line. But, Raoul, if you're asking me about a bailout for state pension funds, I'm not holding my breath.
Okay. Well, I mean, that's going to be a problem at some point. I guess It's not today's problem. Today we've had a liquidity event, not a broader... You know, but if this drags on, then we've got a pension crisis, you know, front and center.